Hey guys, how's it going? This is 02 Infinity from Crowd Control here, recasting the first match between Backdoor Insurance and Team Survival or Death, aka SOD. Sorry about the late upload, guys. We're just a little bit behind in terms of getting videos uploaded and recasted back up on YouTube. But we are going through them as quickly as possible. So once they're all up, hopefully you guys get to see them all. So let's get this started. So, as we mentioned, we are seeing a lot of Undying being banned lately in most of the games just because of Undying's Tombstone. And DC offers so much utility as a support, which is awesome. We're seeing also a ban coming out from Backdoor Insurance. Lena's a fairly popular support just because she's able to transition from a 4-row to a 3-row, especially given the fact that she has the ability to cast stuns or actually just use her passive to carry throughout the game because of the increased attack speed. Another very popular ban we're seeing as well is Viper. Viper, guys, as you all should know, is a very strong mid hero that's excellent in the early to mid games. And if you're going to use Viper, it's typically because you're going for some type of an early finish strategy. Keep in mind, these teams have not played against each other before, so I'm assuming their strategy in picking the bans is solely based on maybe previous experience, if they've seen each other, see one of the members play, or they're just going to ban the more popular or more heroes that are currently in the meta more than anything else. As you guys can see, currently in TI5, the lot playoffs, we're seeing a lot of Gyro, Queen of Pain, as well as the Shrax being picked up, and Undying being banned actually quite often as well. So that could be one of the other things that the players will be going off of based on the bans. We are seeing a Storm Spirit being banned from Backdoor Insurance as well. Backdoor Insurance, just as a mid hero, offers a lot of chasing power if you let him snowball out of the control. The thing with his ultimate is that he can basically zoom across the entire map, especially with a Bloodstone, and have almost practically unlimited mana. It basically allows him to globally gank heroes like crazy. If you get a Black King bar on him and he jumps into the middle of a team fight, it makes it very difficult to bring him down for one, or if he's ends up failing at the gank, he's able to get away very quickly. We're seeing a line come out really early right now from Survival or Death. I think I talk about this a lot in the previous videos and streams I cast. I absolutely love Lion just because he offers so much as a support hero. For one, he gets basically a free sheep stick right from the get-go with his hex, and then his Earth Spike stun actually isn't just a single target stun, it stuns in a line. So if you're able to catch a group of heroes all at once, you can stun them all together. The other thing that's nice too about Lion is that if you get Trinkle Boots on him, it basically offers him a ton of health regeneration, and by using his Life Drain skill, basically keeps him self-sustained in lanes, and he doesn't have to teleport back and forth to his own fountain too much. All he has to do is just teleport from tower to tower to protect, and he can use the Finger of Death actually to just go and instantly burst down any type of hero. Another popular pick we're also seeing a lot in the Crowd Control tournament so far has been a Vengeful Spirit. Vengeful Spirit as a support offers a lot as well. First off, she has a extremely reliable stun with her magic missile, but the other skill I really like on her is her Wave of Terror that actually does armor reduction. As some of you guys may or may not know, if you have somebody have additional armor being reduced, you're going to actually end up taking more damage, or in some cases, it almost feels like you're getting, as Happy put it, many crits over and over and over again. Plus, her swap has a great way to basically save your own team if you get caught in the middle of a gank, or if you want to go down chase a hero and actually get them out of position to get into a team fight. So that's something that's really nice about Vengeful Spirit. We're seeing a Razor being picked up as well from Backdoor Insurance. Razor is actually a really great mid, but the thing that Razor excels most is against heroes that are melee characters. So Earthshaker, Life Stealer, Faceless Void absolutely gets countered by Razor because he steals all their damage, and it makes it so they can't basically obviously have a ton of damage output, and then Razor just has to right-click them a few times and finishes them off. Plus, if you're able to get an Accept on Razor, it makes him extremely strong tower pusher. So based on what we're seeing here, Backdoor Insurance, I'm assuming we're probably going to see the Razor play the mid so we can get a quick level 6 and start roaming around and pushing towers and ganking along with the Vengeful Spirit. Vengeful Spirit's most likely going to end up playing the safe lane for Dire. Now we're seeing Queen of Pain being picked up from Survivor or Death right now. Now Arius from Team Undecided brought up a really good point to me. I didn't quite understand why Queen of Pain was being picked up so often. because I felt that in the 6.83 patch when they changed her, I believe it was Scream of Pain, is it called? No, it was her Sonic Wave. Might have been Scream of Pain. No, it was her Sonic Wave. Yeah, they changed her Sonic Wave from magical damage to pure damage, but then they lowered the amount of damage that it actually outputs. So I felt like that was actually more of a nerf, but Arius put up a good point that when you're going into late game against late game carries, you're going to see everybody start carrying BKBs. And having that pure damage able to go through BKBs makes her very strong in doing quick burst damage, and her escape utility just makes her able to get away much faster, especially since her level 1 blink is and to her level 4 blink all have a 1300 range, which is absolutely a huge escape. Now, we're seeing some additional bans here. Slark, Phantom Lancer from Backdoor Insurance. Slark is just a nightmare to deal with, especially with the new items that have come out in 6.84, such as Night Edge. It makes Slark just a monster ganker. And just, he's so freaking annoying because he can get away with this ultimate unless you have some type of an AoE spell. So it's really hard to take down a Slark if he's properly farmed, or he's just a great offlaner because he has so much escape. Phantom Lancer is just a great tower pusher as well. And I would imagine the reason why Razor may have banned the Phantom Lancer is because there's not a whole lot you can do against a Phantom Lancer without some type of an AoE hero, such as, I'm dropping this right now, Earthshaker, or I would say the other really good one for Phantom Lancer is actually, I believe, Lich with his ultimate, especially with the Night Scepter upgrade. Meanwhile, in Survival or Death, we're seeing Centaur and Bristleback main ban as well. Centaur, as I mentioned before, in 6.84, his ultimate actually has an Night Scepter upgrade now that makes his entire team have 60% damage reduction when he activates it, and they have unobstructed terrain, so they can basically run through anything. So pretty much when Centaur casts his R, it's like the Rite of Valkyries, everybody charges in, does their damage, or it could be a counter engagement and can get away very quickly. Bristleback, on the other hand, is also a very, very tanky offlaner, and the nice thing about Bristleback is he offers a lot of chase down power, just because his nasal goo, I think is what it's called. And on top of that, when he gets his Warpath upgraded, it makes him able to do additional damage. If you get enough mana regeneration on a Bristleback, it makes him very, very hard-hitting, and he's absolutely scary to go against one-on-one. The best counter to a Bristleback is probably to use somebody with pure damage. But either way, they banned the Bristleback from on their team. I'm not quite sure if that might have been in Backdoor Insurance's plan to pick the Bristleback, but again, I think they're just trying to get rid of heroes that they find absolutely annoying to deal with. We're seeing a Warlock come out from Backdoor Insurance. Previously, we usually see Warlock played in a support role, but some good things I've seen is Team on the Side actually even had a match where they used Warlock as their mid, which really threw me off. But the reason why you end up using Warlock as a mid is because you get that fast level 6, he's able to get his golems up, and you can bring so much presence inside of a team fight. But on top of that, he's also able to generate a lot of pushing power. So what I would say here, based on what the lanes are so far, we're probably going to see the Razor go mid. We're going to see the Vengeful Spirit on the safe lane with the Drow Ranger. And I'm guessing we'll probably see Warlock either play in the off lane with what their fifth pick may be, or maybe they might do a defensive tri lane with the Drow Ranger. In the meantime, Survival or Death, I am seeing that they are picking up an Earthshaker. Earthshaker, usually you don't see them stay in lane too often. You actually see them roam between the safe lane and the mid lane to support both the mid and safe lane carries. Just because he has a lot of ganking power in the Fissure, it's not so much that it's just a stun, but it's the fact that that whole line of rocks just stays there for such a long time, makes it very difficult for anybody to escape unless they have like a Force Staff or a Blink of some sort. On top of that, if you are getting into team fights, if everybody's centered in the middle, it makes Earthshaker very scary with his Echo Slam, especially if you're journeying in a lot of illusions. And that would have been a perfect counter if, say, Phantom Lancer was picked by Backdoor Insurance. Now we're seeing a Spectre coming out from Survivor Death as well. Spectre is a very, very squishy early game carry. But if you give her enough time to get online, I would say she's actually one of the more devastating carries because her global presence is just absolutely monstrous. But the other thing too that really makes her scary is the fact that she does pure damage with Desolate and also her dispersion, which makes her very, very tanky later on in game. But she is going to need a lot of protection, so I'm willing to bet that Survivor or Death is probably going to play the Spectre on the safe lane with the Lion and Earthshaker playing as support, and we're going to try to see what kind of an offlane that may be coming from Survivor or Death. Based on their lineup right now and what they're having to deal with the Drow Ranger, I'm actually thinking that there could be a possibility that they might end up using getting another stun, or actually, you know, I'm not sure. My Dota knowledge isn't up enough to really find out what their fifth pick may be. I'm going to think they're probably going to pick some type of a clanky, sorry, some sort of a tanky offlaner. I don't think it'd be a Clockwork though, because a Clockwork wouldn't synergize with your team too well. You know, actually, I think they're probably going to pick either an Enigma or a Tidehunter for Survival or Death, just because the Tidehunter is extremely tanky off-lane, and we're seeing the Clockwork ban there, but the Tidehunter, we could see him going off-lane, offering a lot of team fight, and doing the stuns, and then letting Spectre cast her global ult with Earthshaker doing the Echo Slam cleanup, and Queen of Pain can even go in with the burst damage, or the Enigma. The Enigma would actually be a very excellent pick for Survival or Death right here, just to give them a lot of stopping power, especially with Earthshaker, a combo. We're seeing the Huskar being picked up from Backdoor Insurance. Huskar is just absolutely devastating against magic damage users. I'm not sure if they realize that the Queen of Pain's Sonic Wave is actually pure damage though. So if a Huskar goes and ults a Queen of Pain, you're going to see the Huskar burst out pretty quick. And we're actually seeing a Broodmother come out. So we're going to see the Broodmother go off lane. Broodmother can actually, well, for the first thing, be extremely annoying by being camouflaged the entire time. And on top of that, actually able to push entire lanes by herself. With enough webs covering the map, she's very scary as a ganker. So that's something we're going to see here. So most likely offlane Broodmother, mid Queen of Pain, Spectre, Lion, and Earthshaker going on safe lane with Earthshaker roaming. And then for Backdoor Insurance, we're going to see Razor mid, most likely Drow Ranger in the safe lane with the Vengeful Spirit, possibly the Warlock and Huskar going on the offlane. So let's see what this game gets started and see what happens. Sorry guys, I'm replying to one of the messages here from one of our crowd control members. Okay, so let's take a look and see where everybody's at here. I'm gonna start learning these keyboard shortcuts. I'm not constantly having to click on it. So if you guys are wondering like why I'm doing this, is because I wanna try to learn this a little bit faster. Alright, so which one's net worth? Net worth is Y. Okay. Let's go off to this. Got the standard good luck, have fun. Very StarCraft-ish. I haven't seen people do that in a Dota match for a while. Most of the people on Dota are very bitter, angry people. Or maybe not, I'm just kidding. But you know, you guys get what I'm saying. So we're actually seeing Backdoor Insurance actually start roaming directly to the bottom lane with an early smoke. I think they're going to try to catch SoD's carry in the safe lane as quickly as possible just to get the initial first blood. We are seeing that looks like there is a. Everybody's just actually trying to go for the top rune here, and this play is being seen more and more often. I think they're going to try to catch a Spectre, and they do see the Spectre. Spectre's going to actually get the smoke pop. He's going to immediately retreat back to the tier 2 tower, play it safe, and looks like Backdoor Insurance is going to secure the bottom rune with SoD securing the top rune. So we start having the lanes played out. So we're actually going to see a Warlock and Vengeful Spirit go on the offlane with a Drown Ranger? That'd be interesting. Razor going mid, and then Huskar actually going on the safe lane. It's a very interesting lane setup here. We do see the Broodmother going in the top lane here for Radiance, with Queen of Pain going mid, and the Lion, Spectre, and the Earthshaker going through bottom. I still predict the Earthshaker actually roaming between mid and the safe lane, just because Earthshaker just has so much utility in terms of harassing them. We're seeing a very early ward from the Warlock right in this area here. Generally, guys, if you are putting a ward, this is a great area because it's actually going to allow you to have vision for the entire jungle in case anything comes up. And the other thing too, I actually feel like a better ward would be right here in that position, because that's actually going to allow you to see the bottom room as well, and also see the slain. But either way, both of these wards actually offer you a lot of utility, because he's going to be able to see this area right here in case somebody comes up to try to gank. So we start having the lanes play out, and it looks like the Queen of Pain and Drow are actually doing fairly well. Drow have actually two denies already. Queen of Pain, I think, at this point, is just trying to harass the Razor out of lane. A Queen of Pain against the Razor would actually be a fairly decent matchup for the Queen of Pain, just because if Razor tries to static link her, she's going to be able to blink away, get back in range, and Razor's not going to soak up any damage at all. We're seeing an early Sentry Ward against the Broodmother here from Huskar, which is absolutely critical, guys, if you're going against any invisible heroes of any sort. Not just a Ricky or Bounty Hunter. You should always have Sentry Wards if at the beginning of the lane phase if you know there's going to be an invisible hero. This is the fastest way. It's going to keep them shut down, harass them out of lane, and more or less, if they can't farm in lane, they're going to have to go around jungle or go to some other lane as well, which hopefully you get Sentry set up for, and that just makes it harder and harder for them to get online. So we're going to see the Broodmother actually recounter that Sentry Ward with her own, and this, likewise, getting a Sentry lane to protect your safe lane carry, it's also very important to get a Sentry Ward up as quickly as possible. And we're seeing some wards being placed back and forth, being harassed out. And this Broodmother is going to take the Sentry Ward out from the Huskar. Huskar's not going to do much about it, and Broodmother's simply just going to fade away. And he's going to have to wait for another Sentry Ward to come up, or hopefully wait for her to expose herself. In the meantime here, we got a defensive and aggro tri-lane coming from Backdoor Insurance and Team SoD. We've got the Vengeful Spirit basically threatening the Earthshaker. She's got double damage, which is pretty scary on the Vengeful Spirit, because she has her Vengeance Aura for one and she ends up leveling up, but also she is technically a agility hero, and she can actually be transitioned to a carry semi-carry as well, just like Lina. So that's something to watch out for. Let's take a look and see what everybody's builds are currently at. So we're seeing an early bottle from the Queen of Pain, which is absolutely standard if you are playing mid, as we can see with the Razor as well. That way it gives you some more rune control when you're in-game. And the thing about it too is that if you are playing Dota and you're still in, you know, lower MMRs like I am in 2K MMR, or maybe lower than that, you're not going to see you're seeing people do rune control a lot less, which you should really utilize, because rune control allows you to completely refill your bottle and actually keeps you basically staying in lane a lot longer, so you can actually outlane your enemy hero and actually have a lot more sustain in lane as well. So based on the builds here, we're seeing the Queen of Pain immediately build up the Scream of Pain. Scream of Pain is a great farming spell for one, but the reason why you want to level it up is because it offers a lot of farming utility, and usually you want to max Scream of Pain first because of the AoE, followed with Shadow Strike, and then lastly finishing off Blink. This is going to allow you to chase down enemy heroes, but also, like I said, do a lot more presence early game fights. So it looks like we got an early fight coming out here. Earthshaker is actually going to stun the Warlock. Warlock's going to try to get away to Shadow Ward, hopefully he gets through. And here comes Drow. Drow's coming in to push everybody back with the silence and the frost arrows. And it looks like they're actually going to go through and chase the Drow right now. Drow's going to get stunned by the lion. We see the Vengeful Spirit coming up. She's going to try to provide some support. Her magic missile and wave of terror are online. We're going to go through and chase them away. Drow's going to actually chase the Earthshaker because there's a reduced armor against it. Razor's coming in for the gank. And it looks like everybody's going to retreat back to the tier 1 tower. And we do not have a... we actually did have a first blood. I'm not sure when the Earthshaker went down. I think I actually might have missed that. It looks like the Earthshaker went down in that engagement. So it looks like First Blood might have been awarded to Earthshaker? To who? Let's take a look. So First Blood. Oh, First Blood actually went to Huskar, taking down the Broodmother up top. So looks like I missed that fight when that all happened. But so far, Backdoor Insurance with a little bit of a gold lead because of those two kills, and that's a really cool banner. I'm digging that. I've never actually set up a team before, so all you guys who are watching, if you guys ever want to form a team with me and you guys take time to do it, that would be super awesome of you. Other than that, right now, I mean, the main thing is just making sure your safe lane carry gets away, so that way she doesn't fall more behind in this case a specter, from farming, which she's going to need to get her farm again as quickly as possible so that way she can have a little more sustain. And we are seeing a poor man's shield actually being built by the specter here. This is a very popular item to be built for agility heroes because it gives you 6 agility for one, which is actually obviously more additional damage. But another thing people don't realize is that agility heroes actually get bonus armor every time they have increased points in agility. So we're actually going to see the additional agility there, plus the ring of protection, and also the poor man's shield is going to do additional damage reduction, which is really going to help. I don't think she would have survived that early encounter if she had not had the poor man's shield, so that was very, very helpful. In the meantime, it looks like the Broodmother is actually going through and pushing lanes. There's just so many spiders. I absolutely hate spiders. I find it very annoying, but she's doing really well. Not sure where the Huskar went. It looks like the Huskar went down earlier, and I completely missed that. I keep on missing top lane, guys. Sorry. It's just this, there's a lot of action going on in the top lane, so I really want to see what's going on here. Looks like the Huskar's going to TP in. And we already see 2 sentry wards by the Huskar to recounter this Broodmother. I don't think the Broodmother realizes that she's actually being seen yet. If you're wondering why she's able to still walk through the trees even though the sentry wards are there, it's because the sentry wards technically only work if there's other vision being surrounded at that point. So if there had been a creep here at this point, or another one of your heroes, Broodmother would not have been able to walk through the trees. Now we're seeing Broodmother actually utilize the medium camp here actually to get more spiderlings as well to start pushing this lane, which will make her very annoying. And they Huskar actually sees the Broodmother. He's going to go through and try to attack her, bring her down. Lion is actually right there with the Broodmother to support her. She's going to stun her and hex her, but it looks like the Broodmother is still going to go down from the burning damage from the Huskar. Yeah, Huskar's life break is just absolutely scary. I get scared every time a Huskar jumps me. It feels like a predator is jumping in on you out of nowhere, especially as a Shadowblade. But in the meantime, let's take a look at her lanes here and see where we're at. Looks like this Observer Ward's actually about to expire. We're going to want to make sure you get another ward up as soon as possible, which we actually see a ward in this back end here, which is actually going to allow your team to find out if the enemy team is actually jungling, or, oops, sorry, if they're jungling, or if they're, oh, it looks like we got a team fight here. If they're jungling, or if someone's coming in for a gank. So it looks like everybody's going to try to chase down the Drow, and then we had the Earthshaker actually going through and trying to stall lanes. I think he might have misplaced the Fisher, so and actually let the Drow get away. So it looks like just gonna brief back and forth skirmish, and it looks like Lion is actually gonna go through and support this Broodmother hero, getting the Broodmother taking advantage of the medium camp every time it respawns at the minute mark, so you give yourself some more spiderlings. This is very important if you are playing as a Broodmother. I would say Broodmother's first half is her by herself with her insatiable hunger, but the second thing about her is her webs and her spiderlings. Without her spiderlings, Broodmother really is nothing. Just like Visage, she doesn't have much. And it looks like this Queen of Pain is actually invisible around a bunch of heroes here. I think she's trying to glue for a gank itself. These guys do not see her because there's no sentry ward. They're expecting Broodmother just to stay on top. I think this I think the Queen of Pain is actually just waiting for a setup from her team to go in. Earthshaker looks like he doesn't have enough mana for a Fisher here. Once the Fisher goes up, he's going to go in for the stun. And we see a stun going through. Queen of Pain is actually going to bring down the Warlock. And we see the Drow actually going after her as well. She's going to blink and get away. The Lion quickly teleports bottom. And they secure a kill on the Drow as well. We got two downs for Backdoor Insurance. We do have the score at 4-3 right now. In the meantime, Razor is still farming. He's getting a looks like he's getting a mechanism built as soon as possible, so that way he can assist with a lot of pushes. In the meantime, Broodmother is working. Arya has her Soul Ring, and she's building a Staff of Wizardry. Usually, when I see Broodmother's play, I see them rush a Vlad's, just because the Vlad's is very helpful for your Spiderlings to essentially tank more enemy heroes and actually get some lifesteal for you as well. And it combos very nicely for the Insatiable Hunger. In the meantime, it looks like the Spectre is actually being Fatal Bonded by the Warlock. This is actually a very annoying skill, and I think it's hugely underestimated by a lot of pub players who go against a Warlock. The Fatal Bonds is very devastating if you can chain a lot of creeps together and a lot of heroes, especially in burst damage situations, just because everybody's going to have to be sharing that damage regardless. And as much as the Spectre is trying to stay safe right now, she's going to get take that damage regardless with that creep of how far she is from the distance. So that's something that's very scary, and I think that's actually a very good choice to place a Warlock bottom with the Drow to farm, just to keep the Spectre harassed out of the lane. Again, if you guys can't actually deny, you're going to. It's just better to harass an enemy carry out of lane, because denying actually gives them some experience, whereas harassing them out of lane gets them out of range to soak up any experience at all. So that's actually much more detrimental to them. That's why you also see why one rig supports generally get more, get less levels as well, just because they're not within the lane presence, just to soak up any experience within the area of effect. We are seeing the Broodmother already doing what she does best, which is taking down lane one. There's really not much the Huskar can do about it. Huskar is essentially, he is a ranged hero, but when he starts casting his spells, he does the most damage up close. And at that time, Broodmother is just going to completely surround the Huskar with all her spider lanes. And she's going to be very aggressive about pushing as soon as possible. We see the Razor going top to actually ward off this Broodmother, which I think actually would have been better if they had an earlier lane rotation with the Razor and the Warlock, perhaps. Well, maybe not. Well, it looks like we got a fight going down bottom here, and looks like the Drow is actually going to be brought down. No, actually, Drow gets away. We have the Huskar jumping in to try to take them out, and we see a Lion casting an excellent AoE stun that actually stuns several of Backdoor Insurance's heroes. That Drow is going to go down, though. It looks like the Huskar actually went in for a life break, and he's going to go in for another one against this Queen of Pain here. Queen of Pain does not have any mana, and she's going to go down with an excellent stun from the Vengeful Spirit. So that was a very good play by both teams. Both teams actually suffered quite a bit of a loss, but it looks like it was more in favor of Backdoor Insurance with more XP and gold. In the meantime here, it looks like the Broodmother is actually going to try to chase down the Razor. Razor's going to have to stay in lane at this point just to try to harass the Broodmother out from pushing down the tier 2 tower. Because once the Broodmother pushes down this tower, she's just going to go and push the other lanes as well. So we can see the Sentry Wards actually come out from the Razor. He's just trying to spot where the Broodmother is to bring down those spiders as quickly as possible. Just because they're so annoying to deal with. In the meantime, well, let's give this a quick pause. For some reason I can't click on my map. Oh, there we go. Alright, it looks like the Drow overextended herself, and she's immediately going to be bursted down by the entire SOD team. This is going very bad for the Drow, because it looks like the Drow's not getting a whole lot of farm. Let's take a look at how many deaths she's got so far. So she's at 0-3. That's quite a bit of deaths for a carry. You want to try to keep your carry as safe as possible, so that way they don't fall behind in gold or experience. And right now, Drow is going to be their late game carry, with Razor and Huskar coming in positions 2 and 3. Oh, I don't know why I can't click on the minimap. There we go. So at this point, I think it might be better to have a lane rotation and actually have the Drow go mid and rotate out with the Huskar. Because the minute the Queen of Pain actually jumps on the Drow, she could basically silence her and use the Frost Arrows to just knock her down as quickly as possible. I think that might be a better lineup than the Razor, just because the Razor doesn't really have much of a silence, so he can't really stop the Queen of Pain from getting away if she jumps in on him. And it looks like we have a Vengeful Spirit actually staying within the side shop here. I think she's trying to look for a gank against the Spectre. The Spectre absolutely needs to go down right now, because if she doesn't, she's getting more and more farm. She has not died yet. She was already up one kill. And we actually see a Courier going down. I did not see when the Courier went down. It looks like Backdoor Insurance is able to kill it. Now, that's actually a good way to put the team behind as well, unless they buy another Courier, which is kind of a waste. Whenever a Courier gets killed, you get tons of gold. So one of the things that you'll notice from Nature's Prophet players is that they may end up teleporting here, in this area. And the reason why is because they'll put a ward in this spot here and actually wait for a Courier to walk through. This gives them a vision, and they can immediately teleport in and essentially snipe that Courier and get their team extra gold and basically put the other enemy team behind. In the meantime, let's take a look and see what the Drow is building here. At least she's got her tread boots. Power treads. And she looks like she's going for... Oh, I want to say that's usually the recipe for a Manta style. Yeah, you usually need to build a Yasha for Manta style. We got a lane rotation here with 5 heroes actually trying to push bot. In the meantime, this Broodmother is just going to take advantage of having nobody there and push his top lane by herself as quickly as possible. Very annoying, very frustrating. I think the only other thing more frustrating than Broodmother might be a Nature's Prophet. So it looks like we're going to see this tower being pushed down as quick as possible. There's nothing much that the Earthshaker can really do there in terms of trying to deny that tower. They do pop the glyph as soon as they can, and we immediately see a lane rotation going mid from Backdoor Insurance after they bring that tier 1 tower down, so that way the mid tower does not get pushed through. In the meantime, the Broodmother is just being an annoying Broodmother. Like I said, she's just going to keep on pushing this lane as much as possible and hopefully bring down this entire lane and get some super creeps in, so that way she can start supporting her team in the other lanes. Looks like we had quite a bit of lane rotations. Actually, the Warlock would be a very devastating setup against the Broodmother right now. The Warlock can basically, once he spots the Queen of Pain, he can actually do a Fatal Bond, and it's actually going to link all of her Spiderlings. If you get a nice stun on the Broodmother, he's just going to have to do a Rock Drop, and she's going to take so much damage from the Fatal Bonds around her, and it's basically going to kill her. So that's one thing that the Broodmother really watch out for, and actually be a really good encounter. And we actually see the Broodmother getting a level 3 Dagon already. That's going to be very scary because of her insatiable hunger. That's actually going to allow her to do quick burst damage on the initial attack. And then if there's not that much health left, she can basically Dagon and burst him to death. So in the meantime, looks like the Queen of Pain is trying to get her Aghanim Scepter up as quickly as possible. Let's take a look and see where the XP part is. So it looks like SoD is leading in the about 1700 experience, and there's only about a 1500 gold experience right now. So not a whole lot. Looks like Backdoor Insurance is going to try to go and push for this mid lane. They really need that gold injection for their entire team so they can actually get some warriors built up. And we see the Queen of Pain going in for an early fight to try to bring down the Razor. Warlock's actually going to put down the Golems and actually bring down the Earthshaker and a Lion. So that team fight did not go very well for them. I think the Queen of Pain tried to engage a little bit prematurely. Didn't expect them to expect a Warlock to do his ultimate, and unfortunately the Lion and Earthshaker were brought down fairly early, so they didn't have much stuns left to actually win that team fight. So it looks like the Queen of Pain's going to have to retreat to stay back, not get killed, and we're seeing the Spectre actually casting her ult to try to get some global damage. In the meantime, the Broodmother is just trying to take advantage of space being created and take down his tower as quickly as possible, because the rest of his team is actually being pressured mid fairly well. The Spectre is going to have to get away. Doesn't look like there's any wards from the Dire side to spot that the Spectre is in the area right there. Otherwise, I think the Huskar could actually rout her and kill her with his life break. In the meantime, looks like the Broodmother does get spotted, and we're going to try to focus the Broodmother down before she gets away. It looks like that Sentry Ward actually was able to save the Razor there. That was a big kill for them, just because the Broodmother was just pushing that lane so hard, and they just needed to take her out just for a quick second so they could have some time to recuperate themselves and try to push down the other lane so they can get some advantage here. It looks like we got a signal from the Earthshaker to go for the bottom lane, and we see a smoke from the Earthshaker. Oh, actually, he picked up an invisibility rune. Actually, an invisibility rune for an Earthshaker is awesome. It's the next best thing he can get to a Blink Dagger when it comes to teamfights, because all he has to do is just walk right in the center of this entire enemy team right now that's coming up, and basically do an Echo Slam to take them out. But he still does not have his Echo Slam yet, which would be extremely devastating in this teamfight right now. Wish he had it, because that would have been an awesome team battle to fight. So it looks like Backdoor Insurance is actually going to push down this mid lane right here. They will get that, and the entire team is going to get a nice gold injection. It looks like Team SoD is going to have to retreat to the high ground and try to defend this lane on the high ground. Meanwhile, the Broodmother is going to go back up top again to try and repush this lane and bring down this tier 3 tower. Looks like everybody's signaling for something, not quite sure what. Well, in the meantime, since Backdoor Insurance is actually 5 men pushing the mid lane, the Spectre is going to take advantage of this as well to hurry up and split push and get some farm up as quickly as possible. She is going to cast her Haunt to try to split the teamfight and harass him out of the lane. When we see her come back, it looks like she does come straight back to town. Just right in time for the teamfight to bring down the Huskar and the Razor. I did not see that go down. Maybe I should replay it and see what happened. Yeah, let's take a look. I actually want to see what happened in this team fight here. Alright, guys. I don't know what happened to the music. This is very awkward. I don't know where the music went. This is awkward. Sorry, guys. It drives me nuts if there's no music going on. Really like to hear the music. Sorry, guys. Can't join your game right now because I'm casting this awesome match. Where's my music? Maybe I should pause next time. Oh, I guess we'll just deal without the music for the rest of this cast. There it is. There's some music again. I want to see what happened in this fight, because it looks like the Huskar gets brought down really early. You see the Huskar actually go through and jump the Lion. Lion's going to spike, and he's going to be brought down. Razor tries to overextend right behind the Lion. And SoD just had all of their supports there actually bring in the stuns and just keep the Razor and the Huskar from killing the Lion. So it turned out very quick. It's very scary to jump a Lion because he just offers so much disables and he has so much burst damage as well. It's really scary. It looks like this Lion is actually going to be saving up for a Blink Dagger as well. Blink Dagger is a... if you're a new player and you don't know how to stay alive as a Lion, it's very difficult to farm a Blink Dagger. But if you can get that skill down, it's very nice to have a Blink Dagger because it offers Lion a lot of quick engagement and a sudden jump on heroes and ganking power. So that's something you really want to watch out for. Meanwhile, the Broodmother is actually trying to push this Lion as quickly as possible using all of her Spiderlings. Backdoor Insurance is going to react to this by sending their entire team back, and Broodmother is just going to hide in this jungle and just use her Spiderlings to push the Lion as much as possible. In the meantime, the Earthshaker is actually going to check the Roshan Pit. It looks like he's placing a very nice ward in this area. I've mentioned before in a lot of games that I like this ward because it just offers you so much vision. I mean, look at all that vision they can see there. The only other thing that could be better than this is actually getting a sentry ward in that same spot so that way it can spot everything else, and perhaps a sentry ward here. Or actually, no, here would be better because that way you can see both clips to make sure that the enemy doesn't have any wards there, so that way your team can get a safe Roshan in. In the meantime, SoD is actually going to go push down the bottom lane from Dire's side, and you're going to get a nice quick gold injection there. And, I think looks like the Spectre is actually trying to get a Radiance next right now. Generally, the sooner you can rush Radiance, the better. Radiance stacks very nicely with Spectre because it actually works with her illusions, so just offers a lot more damage within the team fights. In the meantime, it looks like the Queen of Pain is going to try to jump the Eventual Spirit. Eventual Spirit is going to be able to escape with her Magic Missile, but she's going to need to make sure her entire team is here, because if she's by herself against this full team, she's going to be brought down very quickly. As we can already see, the Lion was able to use that Blink Dagger, jump on Eventual Spirit, stun, and quickly do a Finger of Death. And it looks like they are down two heroes right now. They could really use the Warlock in this case to get into this team fight as soon as possible, which we are seeing the Huskar actually TPing in, the Warlock actually wandering bottom. I think it might have been better if the Warlock had been able to afford it to just buy the TP scroll and just teleport down there instead of walking, because he would have been able to engage in the team fight much sooner and actually be able to stun this team before they got away. In the meantime, Broodmother is still being left alone. There's just so much pressure for Backdoor Insurance. It's going to make this very hard for them to defend the lanes, because the Broodmother can push entire lanes by herself. And unfortunately, Backdoor Insurance doesn't have a lot of options because they're too busy trying to react to the Spectre and Queen of Pain and Earthshaker and Lion pushing the other lanes out. So it looks like we're going to try to push this in their favor by trying to rush to Roshan as quickly as possible. I really feel like the Eventual Spirit needs to get in here as soon as possible so that way she can use her Wave of Terror, bring down Roshan's armor so that way they can do more damage and get this Roshan taken care of. Quick Wave of Terror would be useful right here. There it is. The Wave of Terror actually travels for quite a bit of range, so it's actually not a bad idea to cast it even earlier. If you know for sure it's right on the outskirts, so you don't have to wander as far. And I think that would have, it would have saved them maybe like 3-5 seconds, which doesn't seem much, but in a given Dota, that 3-5 seconds is just enough time for maybe another hero to TP in or get another kill in. So we are seeing a sentry ward here for the Broodmother to try to hopefully counter her, but I think it might be better to put the sentry ward right there, as we can see the Eventual Spirit do, to take down the Observer wards, which is very much needed. This Broodmother is just going to stay here and just be annoying. Very, very frustrating for Backdoor Insurance, I would imagine, if I was playing against this team. Really, they need that. They would need an Earthshaker to engage this Broodmother as soon as possible. That would just one-shot kill her, which would be really nice, but fortunately, Earthshaker is on the same team as Broodmother, and it looks like the Broodmother's got a level 5 Dagon. That's very powerful, because if she uses her Insatiable Hunger against somebody, she can actually go through and do it quickly. See, 120 plus whatever damage she has, it's 200 already, plus 800, so it's a quick 1000 damage burst, so she can essentially almost kill support heroes in one shot. It looks like we have a team fight come down through the middle here. Does the Earthshaker have his Blink Dagger yet? He still doesn't have his Blink Dagger. I think he's just a bit behind because he's been dying a few times. And on top of that, I think he's just trying to get some wards up for his team as quickly as possible. But the Lion was able to get his Blink first. I think it's kind of a tough call. I think it was actually better to have the Lion get the Blink Dagger before the Earthshaker, because the Lion offers a little bit more utility than the Earthshaker does. So in the meantime, see what kills her again. We're still seeing the Drow Ranger just a bit behind. I mean, she's still getting the important items up. She's got her Yasha as well as her BKB, but I think she would have been able to benefit a lot more if she's been able to secure some of those last hits on those kills. In the meantime, we're seeing the Razor actually trying to defend against a Broodmother, which actually is not a bad idea, because out of their entire lineup, looks like the Razor and Warlock are going to be the ones that could defend the best, and based on the teamfights that are going down right now, it might be better to have the Warlock available, so that way he has his presence of the Fatal Bonds along with his Rock Drop to try to swing the team fights in their favor. We're seeing a Glyph being popped up from Radiant's side to try to defend his tower and push him back a little bit. In the meantime, this Broodmother is just going to keep on harassing, and this Razor is just stuck in the sling. Not a whole lot he can really do. He is trying to finish his Aghanim Scepter, but he's about 2,400 gold off. Sorry, 1,400 gold off. And we're already seeing how deadly that Lion and Queen of Pain combo is going to be. Just a quick burst damage. Queen of Pain goes in, does her Scream of Pain and Sonic Boom, and then Lion does a finger. And you pretty much have a dead hero unless they have a BKB available. In the meantime, we've seen Echo Slam coming out. The Urshaker is actually going to go through and fight the Huskar. Huskar jumps on the Urshaker and stuns him. We're going to see the Queen of Pain actually bring down the Warlock. Looks like the Huskar is trying to try to do as much damage as possible. Everybody's just going to right-click him to death. The Aegis is going to pop up, and it looks like everybody's going to have to retreat, because a full life Huskar basically allows him to do a quick life break, which is one of the things that makes them very annoying. Actually, a very fun combo, guys, that the C play is Huskar and Oracle, just because Oracle can cast his ultimate on Huskar, and Huskar can just go in and basically throw his Flaming Spears all he wants, like an Amazon, and just kill shit over and over. So, fun stuff. Looks like he's actually going to grab the Bounty Rune here. And it looks like the Aegis Styx was used in that last team fight, which, not sure if it was worth it because they weren't able to get any racks down, and it really didn't swing much in their favor in terms of team fight. So give me a sec here. Sorry guys, giving a lot of Facebook pings. I think we're just we have people organizing the matches here. And we have a Queen of Pain actually bottling a double damage rune. She's gonna go through and wonder. She's already got her Ag Scepter built up already. Ag Scepter, obviously, is a nice upgrade for many heroes, because it usually upgrades their ultimate in some form or another. In Queen of Pain's situation, it's actually going to make her damage go up higher and actually lower her cooldown. And don't forget, that ultimate is now pure damage as well. So if he's going against a hero like Drow, which Drow's health is relatively low, she's going to burst the Drow down very quickly with her spells. So it looks like we have a gank that might be coming in right here. Queen of Pain's going to back off because she did see the Vengeful Spirit coming in as well, which assumes that their entire team is probably there. But I think if the Drow's by herself, the Queen of Pain probably would have been able to secure that kill. We're seeing some Sentry Wards actually coming out from the line, which is definitely needed for the Radiant side. I mean, they got a nice aggressive ward in that spot right there. Let's see if you can see my mouse cursor. I can't even click right now. I don't even know why. We have another ward right here as well. Although I think having a ward in this area might be a little bit better, because actually it's going to give some better sight of the river for the Radiant side. Let's take a look and see what their vision's like. So Queen of Pain, yeah, they're able to see some aggressive lanes. We're not able to see that mid lane as well, but we did see the Lion actually place that ward right there. Then let's take a look and see what the Razor sees. Yeah, it looks like Backdoor Insurance could actually use some additional wards as well to defend a little bit better, so that way they can really see more of the map. They don't have a whole lot of map control right now. As you guys can see, most of this area here is just not warded, which makes it very difficult for them to do anything. In the meantime, it looks like Backdoor Insurance is actually going to try to go for another push through mid again. We're going to see them being stunned by their Earthshaker Fissure, which is just a great, really, it's a huge AoE stun. So that's something that's really nice. And it looks like they got very annoyed by the Broodmother, so they actually start carrying dust, but the Broodmother is actually pushing top lane here. So it might be... Well, I guess it really doesn't make a difference, because you are going to want to have the Huskar have dust on him regardless, because if he jumps a hero and they go on Viz, it doesn't allow him to finish them off, and it makes his life break basically useless. They are going to go through and commit and finishing that tower. I think they're going to try to take down the other towers as well. We have a long life break there. That's such a fun skill to watch because he's just able to go through and just go through and follow you no matter where you go. It's very entertaining to watch when they just seem like they fly forever. And Oreo saw the mistake with the Huskar jumping in on the Queen of Pain. Getting Queen of Pain's ultimate is actually pure damage, so even though Huskar is magically resistant, that pure damage is going to bring them down regardless. In the meantime, looks like we have a 4-man wipe from that Backdoor Insurance. Razor is still having to defend that top lane against that Broodmother that I was just pushing earlier. And that was a very quick response from everybody on Team SoD. Broodmother with her Dagon is very, very annoying for burst damage as well. This Drow is probably going to be the number one target to bring down, followed by their Warlock, because everybody else isn't offering a whole lot of damage. Does Razor have his Axe Scepter yet? Razor does not have his Axe Scepter yet either, so he's not offering a whole lot of damage utility. And plus the fact, in the middle of those team fights here, he's not able to get his good static link on anybody, which is where a majority of Razor's damage comes from. So, in the meantime, looks like Earthshaker was able to finish his Blink Dagger from that fight, and his Echo Slam is up. So, the next team fight that we see pop out, we're going to see a nasty engagement from Team SLD. It looks like Backdoor Insurance actually placed a very aggressive ward uphill on this mid lane here. I think they're actually just trying to take this lane as possible. It looks like they're going for another push mid, as we can see here, with the Heroes Gathering. But this team fight is getting more and more difficult as it goes on, because the Spectre has been farming this bottom lane nonstop, and she basically doesn't go back on any team fights unless she's just using Haunt. Otherwise, she just goes back and teleports back bottom again to refarm everything. And it looks like she actually got a Diffusal Blade. That makes sense. A Diffusal Blade would offer a little bit more utility than a Radiance, because Radiance is just pure damage. Not pure damage, it just offers more damage over time. Whereas the Diffusal Blade actually takes out the enemy team's mana, but also offers a Purge. And a Purge is very useful in terms of basically keeping your hero, basically keeping any of your team's heroes from going down real fast. We're seeing actually the Broodmother being brought. Oh, and he doesn't get brought down. He does manage to make an escape. It looks like the Queen of Pain is going to come through and actually bring down a Drow, a Warlock, and the Razor is going to go down. And we have another 4-man team fight from the Huskar. This is not going well in the team fights for Backdoor Insurance. It's actually just pushing them more and more behind. That fight did not go well for them. Looks like a 3,000 gold exchange and a 5,000 XP gain for Team SOD. It looks like they only lost to Earthshaker there, and I'm assuming it's because he probably went in there for the Echo Slam and he got focused down immediately. But like I was mentioning earlier, the reason why it's actually a good idea to have a Diffusal Blade is not only do you use the Diffusal Blade on yourself or your only team's heroes if they have some type of stun or a debuff on them and a removes ability, but the Purge actually slows down a hero too. So as a Spectre, if you're trying to chase down a hero, a nice way to do it is actually to throw in a Diffusal Blade, throw in a Spectral Dagger, and then start chasing that enemy hero. Because once the Spectral Dagger actually hits the enemy hero, Spectre can basically travel along that Shadow Path, and the Shadow Path will actually follow the enemy hero the entire time and give extra movement speed for the Spectre, which makes her a nice ganking machine. I really like that. It looks like we actually have the Radiance trying to be finished right now by the Spectre itself. She's just missing the recipe. And we're seeing Broodmother in the meantime just farm the crap out of these lanes. And looks like she's actually going to try to... She doesn't have boots yet, so I'm not sure what her next item might be. I think it might be a good idea to get boots of travel so she can go from lane to lane to lane to lane and just be a huge nuisance. Or maybe just finish her boots. I think it might be a good idea to pick up Lads at this point. I mean, it is a little bit later game, but it's just going to keep her Spider Survival for a little bit longer. Maybe I'm wrong. Actually, you know what? I take that back. Based on their team lineup, doesn't look like anybody has a mechanism, which at this point I guess it wouldn't offer as much. But I think what would be a good item to build, it could be built by the Broodmother because she has to engage anyways, or perhaps the Liner or Shaker, is a Pipe of Insight, because we do have some decent magic damage coming from Backdoor Insurance, and that will actually help them tank it a little bit. In the meantime, Backdoor Insurance is actually going to go ward up the spot and try to take a Roshan as down quick as possible. They do need a Roshan to get some level gains and maybe offer them an extra life in the middle of a team fight. We also see Huskar picking up a Gem of True Sight as well. I'm assuming that actually for the Broodmother, but I would also say it's probably for the Queen of Pain because she's got a Shadow Blade up. In the meantime, looks like the Warlock is going to be brought down as he was trying to defend his top lane here against SoD, and Broodmother's just going to go back in and try to bring down the melee racks. And guys, it's if you're ever not sure which racks is which, all I do is just click on it, and it'll give you the nice description there. The reason why you want to bring down the melee racks first over the range racks is because the melee racks ends up buffing your melee creeps. And you're like, well, duh, obviously it makes sense. But remember, every creep wave that comes out, you always have more melee creeps than you do have range creeps. So by buffing your melee creeps, it gives you a lot more lane presence to push that, and makes it harder for the enemy team to deal with, and they have to respond back to those towers a lot faster. So that's why you always see the melee creeps go down, melee racks go down first. So, in case you guys want to make a difference in your games, that's a really good way to start. Like I said, just make sure you press down the melee bears as quickly as possible. And it looks like the Queen of Pain actually converted her Shadow Blade to a Silver Edge, which is one of the new items here. This thing is awesome. It's great because it's going to deal additional 225 bonus damage. It basically has the same passives as a Sage, and also offers you that Shadow Walk ability. So that's a great item to build from the Shadow Blade. Usually before, if you built the Shadow Blade, you usually throw the Shadow Blade away at some other point to buy something else. You do see Drows pick them up every once in a while to offer some additional attack speed or some type of a mechanism for escape, since Drow herself doesn't actually have an escape mechanism at all. It looks like they're going to go through and try to push this mid lane again. I think it's just because there's no other choice. They don't have the tier 2 towers pushed out for the Radiant bottom or top towers, just the mid lane itself. And at this point, they desperately need some type of racks just to give some additional presence. In the meantime, this Broodmother is just going to go through and start harassing this tower. And she's just going to try to tank everything using her Necronomicon and also generating more and more Spiderlings too. This is very frustrating for Backdoor Insurance, because now they're having to try to push down this mid lane as well as defending home. And looks like we're going to see the Razor using his Ag Scepter to bring down that Rax as quickly as possible. Like I mentioned, guys, looks like a nice Echo Slam from the Earthshaker. He's going to go through and cast his Echo Slam with a Fissure to do an additional stun. Queen of Pain is going to go through, cross her Sonic Boom and her Scream of Pain to bring down the enemy heroes. Huskar is going to lose his Gem of True Sight to the Lion. He's going to be brought, and looks like the Drow's going to be brought right back up and gets fingered by the Lion. That sounded sexual, but yeah, that team fight did not go well for them either, unfortunately. And in the meantime, during that whole team fight, the Broodmother was able to bring down the range barracks for SOD. This is not going very well for Backdoor Insurance. They are basically one racks behind. They do have that mid lane pushed out, but unfortunately, so is the Broodmother. She has the top lane pushed out as well. Huskar was able to get a good jump on the Broodmother to take her out. Which is much needed because she's so annoying. She's going to be down for 78 seconds, so at this point, it'd be a really good idea for Team Backdoor Insurance to try to take out that top tower as soon as possible, just to try to get these super creeps off of their lane, give them a little more breathing room, so that way to even things up. In the meantime, it looks like Spectre is actually going to go through and just farm her jungle as quick as possible. I would say it might be a better idea to actually have the Spectre go through and farm Dire's jungle, because at this point, if you're pushing your lanes in that much, often farming the enemy's jungle basically bleeds them out. They have no choice but to farm the creeps, because they can't farm the jungle creeps, since mostly everything will be dead for one. And the other thing too is that it makes them, by farming your jungle creeps, it forces them to actually have to move out of the fount, out of their own base, to farm the creeps that are coming in lane. And if the creeps aren't coming in lane, they're going to have to wander out anyways, which just really puts their entire team at risk for a gank for your team. So that's why if you guys already have a nice lane presence and everything's dominated, get some good wards up like this one, or maybe one right there, and start farming their jungle camp, so that way they can't farm back up to try to retaliate. So Backdoor Insurance, I think what they're doing right now is trying to go for a final push. I think they know they're not going to be able to win the lanes, so they're going to try to go for a fast victory by pushing down mid as quickly as possible. And they're really going to need to actually bring down these mid towers as soon as they can. In the meantime, it looks like the Spectre does have to TP back. And again, a huge Echo Slam from the Earthshaker. And we're going to see a Rock Drop from the Golem to try to counter that fight. And unfortunately, Razor's going down, Ventral Spirit goes down, Huskar is going down, Warlock goes down, and we still do not have an enemy hero coming down from Team SOD yet. Queen of Pain is going to burst down as well. And it looks like we have a GG being called from Backdoor Insurance. I think that was the last-ditch effort to try to push for the mid lane to finish fast. Dane Neuter is not a whole lot they can really do against that Brewmother, just basically being in lane presence, going from lane to lane. Very frustrating. And we actually see the Razor calling out to Broodmother as a very good pick. It was very difficult for them to deal with. So that's match one for Backdoor Insurance versus Survival or Death. We will get this video uploaded and let me know what you guys think. We'll get to game number two casted here as soon as possible. And hope to catch you guys again. This is Zero to Infinity from Crowd Control. Thanks for watching, guys.